कृष्ण प्रभु धन्यवाद।
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु धन्य प्रभु प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माय हम्बल ऑफिसेस।
हरे कृष्णा
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी धन्यवाद प्रभु
धन्यवाद विश्वेश्वर प्रभु
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु यस
So, Prabhu, today you are able to send the message in group that
regarding Prabhu.
Today's class, did you send the message to anybody?
I didn't specifically send. I'll drop a line, Prabhu. I'll do that.
नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते राधागोविन्दगोस्वामीति नामिने नमस्ते प्रभुपाद्य देवं गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादे ग्रमणाजननिस्तारिणे नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदन्त स्वामीति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादे पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वंशाकल्पतरोभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्येव च प्रतीतानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्याद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवत्युत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिके। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। Hare Krishna, dear devotees, welcome back to chapter 13th. So while we are entering into Srimad Bhagavat, as an introduction, we have completed first 12 chapters. And today we are going to enter into chapter 13th. This is the last class in unit 4. And here in the previous lesson, lesson number 4, we are discussing about Parikshit's situation in the womb of his mother. And during the conceive of the child, how astrological influence helps to get a good child, that we have seen. Therefore, Maharaj Parikshit had all the good qualities, and because when the Parikshit Maharaj was born, Maharaj Yudhishthir, he consulted with the Brahmanas, and he heard about the good qualities of his grandson. He worshipped the Supreme Lord, he distributed charities. Then in the same line we heard about him performing the horse sacrifice. Then he became the king of the Hastinapur. And then finally Krishna, he stayed there for a few more days, and then he departed Dwaraka, this time accompanied by Arjuna. So here we are hearing about Maharaj Parikshit. He has just taken birth. Now in the beginning, the sages in Naimisharanya, they had asked questions to know about the birth and activities of Maharaj Parikshit, which will give rise to Krishna Katha, the topic about Krishna. So obviously this is a natural fact that after Maharaj Parikshit was born, his activities like chastising Kali and his other activities must be described. But now there is a shift in the discussion between the sages in Naimisharanya and the Suta Goswami. So in the beginning, he is actually going to talk about in 3 chapters, he is going to speak about how Vidura, who was traveling on the places of pilgrimage, he returned back to Hastinapur, and he instructed Dhritarashtra. That's how, upon hearing the instructions from his younger brother, Dhritarashtra quits home along with Gandhari, and then after that, in the next chapter, we'll be hearing about Arjuna's return from Dwaraka, and he will give the message about Krishna's disappearance, and then finally, the departure of the Pandavas will be described. So before describing the activities of Maharaj Parikshit. So now, in the beginning of chapter 13, the chapter summary is like this. Upon hearing instructions of Vidura, Dhritarashtra could here in this connection, we will see how when Vidura, while on the pilgrimage, he met with Uddhava first in Dwaraka. And then upon hearing about his relatives' situation, and also he was instructed by Uddhava that Lord has given the set of instructions which he can receive from Maitra Rishi. So after meeting with Uddhava, he went to Haridwar, where he met with Maitra Rishi, and he asked questions to Maitra. And just after hearing answer for 3 or 4 questions, his devotion to Lord Govinda was awakened, and he attained the maturity of the knowledge he received from Maitreya. Therefore, he thought of his younger brother Dhritarashtra, that now I should go back and help him to attain perfection. Therefore, he turns back to Hastinapur, and upon giving instructions to Dhritarashtra, he helps him quit home, and Dhritarashtra goes to Haridwar, where by performing Ashtanga Yoga, he attains perfection. Then coronation of Maharaj Parikshit and attainment of liberation by Maharaj Yudhishthira. So these are the things we'll discuss in due course. So at first, Vidura's return to Hastinapur, then finally, Narad Muni instructions to King Yudhishthira, and hints that the Lord's pastimes may come to an end. Therefore, there is no need for you to go and search for Dhritarashtra and Gandhari. And finally, Narad explains that Dhritarashtra will give up his body performing mystic yoga. You don't have to go there to perform the final rites. So in that way, in the beginning, Sruta Uvacha. Vidurastirthayatrayam maitreyadatmano gatim jnatvagadhastinapuram tayavapta vivitsitaha. Sri Sruta Goswami said, while traveling on a pilgrimage, Vidura received knowledge of the destination of the self, Atmanagatim. So he received instruction from Maitreya about the self, certain self-realization. And then returned to Hastinapur. He became as well versed in the subject as he described. So here, all of a sudden, the topic about Vidura comes into existence. Because this is a subject matter of Mahabharata, it is not very detailed description is given here. There is no detailed description given here. So we know that before Mahabharata war, there is some discussion going on between Dhritarashtra and Vidura. Vidura always took side of the Pandavas. Somehow or other, Dhritarashtra didn't like that. In spite of repeatedly giving good counsel to Dhritarashtra, still he was ignoring Vidura. So Vidura finally decided that there is no use in giving him further instruction when he was acted by the affection to his sons. And it so happened that one day when Dhritarashtra was talking to Vidura, Vidura was talking to Dhritarashtra about how he should not be so much affectionate to Duryodhan. Came to a point when Vidura said, he said, Dhritarashtra, my dear brother, do you not know this Duryodhan, who you are so much affectionate to, he is born as a part of Kali, and he will be the cause of the destruction of the entire dynasty. And at that time, Duryodhan entered, and he heard what Vidura just spoke about him to his father. And Duryodhan became very upset with him. In fact, he dared speaking about how Vidura, being the son of a Shudra, dares to talk against him. And finally, Vidura decided, no, there is no point in staying in this house. So he left. And after that, he went on traveling different holy places of pilgrimage. And by the time he came to Dwaraka, where he met with Uddhava, by then the Kurukshetra war had ended. But anyway, he heard everything from him. At the same time, he knew that Lord wanted him to receive the knowledge of Srimad Bhagavatam from Maitreya Rishi. Therefore, Uddhava instructed Vidura. Actually, it so happened that Vidura asked Uddhava, what did Lord say while leaving about me? Did he leave any instruction for me? Then Uddhava said, yes, but I am not qualified to talk. Because Uddhava felt when an elderly person like Maitreya was still present, he should speak about Srimad Bhagavatam. Because when Lord instructed Srimad Bhagavatam, that time both Uddhava and Maitreya, they are present. So Uddhava denied to speak, reveal the instructions of the Lord, because he wanted to respect Maitreya Rishi, who was elderly. So he told Vidura that you go to Maitreya, and he received this instruction from him. Therefore, he went to Maitreya Muni and he met him in Haridwar. Therefore, Maitreyat Atmanagatim, he received this knowledge about self from Maitreya, and Gyatagat Hastinapuram. So upon hearing this, he remembered that, oh, my brother, he's also in house and he's suffering. He should also get this knowledge and he should attain perfection. That's why Taya Vapta Vivitsitahi. That means he has understood the knowledge clearly. Now he's going back to Hastinapur to help his brother. So in that way, now let us read from the book. Okay, I'll just read.
Javata Kritavan Prasna Kshatta Kausar Vagratah Jataika Bhakti Govinde Tebhyo Soparama Parama Uparamaha. So after hearing the answer for first questions, his devotion to Govinda was awakened. Therefore, he did not speak any further questions. And then in that way, when they saw Vidura return to palace, means After receiving the knowledge from Maitreya Muni, Vidura returned back to Hastinapur. And he came back, then Maharaj Yudhishthir, along with the different members, who are there? Dhrita, Dharmaputra Maharaja, Dhritarashtra, Jujutsushcha, Suta, Sarad, Vatapritha. Along with Dhritarashtra, Jujutsu, Suta means Sanjaya, Saradvata is Kripacharya, Pritha is Kunti, Gandhari, Draupadi, and Kripi. So in that way, Anyascha Jamaya, and the ladies of his other relatives, along with their children, they all came, and Maharaj Yudhishthir greeted Vidura. And in that connection, it is said that Patya Jagnu Paharsena Pranam Tanma Ivagata. Actually, Vidura was like the life and soul for the Pandavas, because he was always favoring them. And therefore, when Maharaj Yudhishthir, he saw Vidura had returned to Hastinapur, so it is explained here that as if life had returned to their bodies, they were so dear to him. Due to anxieties and long separation, they all cried out of affection. King Yudhishthira then arranged to offer sitting accommodation and a reception. So in that way, when Vidura arrived, Maharaj Yudhishthira, along with his brothers and other family members, he greeted Vidura and he gave him nice prasadam. Then Vidura rested for a while. And after that, Maharaj Yudhishthira started discussing, talking to him. Yudhishthira vacha. Api smaratama ajusma pakha paksha chaya sameditam vipad ganad visadhnya de mochita jat samatrika. So he is saying that along with our mother Kunti, you have always actually protected us. You have given your favor in different situations, like you protected us from the poison. And when we are sent to Varnabrat, where we are put into Lakshagriha, the house made of luck. And there was supposed to be a fire, but actually by your protection, you are saved, you escaped. So in that way, he is saying that you have always favored us, you have always given your protection. So then after that, he's asking, when you are traveling in these places of pilgrimage, so how did you maintain yourself? How did you eat? And so what happened to you? Then finally he said, Bhavad Vidha Bhagavata Tirtha Bhuta Swayam Bhuho Tirthi Kurvanti Tirthani Santastena Vadaprita. He's glorifying Maharaj, Vidura, who is a great devotee of the Lord, that he's saying the devotees of the Lord, they travel to the places of pilgrimage not to benefit themselves. Because there is no need for them to go to these places of pilgrimage. Why do they go? Because Tirthi Kurvanti Tirthani. They even purify the places of pilgrimage. That is the beauty of the sadhus, because Santastena Gadabhita, they always carry Lord in their heart. So in their way, by traveling to the holy places of pilgrimage, they hold the potency of even purifying the holy places. We have heard from the story of Mother Ganges, while she was descending to this earth planet, when Bhagiratha requested her, then Ganga Devi, she said, if I go to this earth planet, what will happen to me? All these people, sinful people, they will come and they'll wash their sin on me, and I will be filled with sins. So what will be my way for deliverance? Then he said, no, these saintly persons, when they will come and they will take bath in you, that's how you will become free from the sins. So therefore, in this connection, Srila Prabhupada also explains that we devotees, when we go to the places of pilgrimage, we must seek out the association of the saintly persons like Vidura, and upon hearing from them, we can attain perfection. Such pure devotees, Prabhupada is saying, such pure devotees are able to rectify the polluted atmospheres of any place. And what to speak of a holy place rendered unholy by the questionable actions of interested persons who try to adopt a professional life at the cost of the reputation of a holy place. So there are always people available in the holy tirthas who are creating pollution. The sadhus, they actually, by the very act of their devotional service, they bring purity, they preserve the purity of the holy place so that others can come and take benefit from. Therefore, when we go to the holy places, we must seek out the association of such saintly persons, we must hear from them, and we perfect our Krishna consciousness. Then he continues, api na suhita stata bandhava Krishna devata. Oh, then he started asking about the Dwarakavasis. Dwarakavasis, they have accepted Krishna as their own Lord and protector. So then he is saying, Drishtva Suta va Yadavaha So Puriyam Sukhamasate. Can you give us an information about the Yadavas? Are they all living happily in their abode? So how, what about them? So then he asked about the Dwarakavasis. Ityukta dharmarajena sarvam tat samvarnayat yathanu bhutam kramasho vina jadukla kshayam. Thus, being questioned by Maharaj Yudhishthira, Mahatma Vidura gradually described everything he had personally experienced, except news of the annihilation of the Yadu dynasty. It's a very interesting point. Actually, when you meet with your near and dear one, you are not supposed to reveal the messages which will bring grief to your near and dear one. So because Pandavas were very much dear to Vidura, and he knew that if he is going to how Krishna has already left the planet, that will not be very much released by the Pandavas. So he is thinking in due course of time, anyway, they will come to know, why should I unnecessarily reveal this fact to them, thereby make them more aggrieved. So he didn't speak about that. Compassionate Mahatma Vidura could not stand to see the Pandavas distressed at any time. Therefore, he did not disclose this unpalatable and unbearable incident because calamities come on their own accord. Prabhupada writes, according to Niti Shastra, civic laws, one should not speak an unpalatable truth to cause distress to others. Even though it's a truth, but we should not speak because it will bring distress. Then and continues in that way, this kanchit kalam matha vasit sweet sakrit sadkrito sadkrito devata sukham. So Vidura, he stayed with the Pandavas for some time. Question can be asked, why? Because he came after a long time, they are giving him devata sukham, devavat sukham. He was given a very nice treatment, like one will regard the demigods. So he was having so many, you know, good thing to enjoy. Therefore he stayed there. No, bhratur jasthasya seyas krita sarvesam sukhamavah. Actually, he stayed there. This is also a common human behavior, you see. when you meet with your near and dear one, how you should behave with them? You go there after a long time and they are very much distressed because you did not meet with them for a long time. Then you spend some time with them because they feel happy about you staying with them. So here, Sukamara, Sarvisham. So all these devotees in Hastinapur, they were very much in love with Vidura. They wanted him to stay there with them. So he stayed with them for some time, just to pacify them, give them some joy. And then at the same time, he was thinking how he is going to help his brother Dhritarashtra, because Dhritarashtra is already gone case. So I have to help him to come out of this home. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, talks of spiritual enlightenment are so refreshing. Anyway, we'll see it afterwards. Then, as long as Vidura played the part of a Shudra being cursed by Mundaka Muni, Aryama officiated at the post of Yamaraj to punish those who committed sinful acts. So here it is said that this Vidura, he was not an ordinary person. He was an incarnation of Yamaraj. And when he came as Vidura, he was cursed to stay in this earthliness for 100 years. Sapad Varsa Satam Yama, being cursed, he was born. Yamaraj was born as Vidura for 100 years. So in this connection, I was thinking to ask you this question. Maybe someone can explain to us. I hope you have read this, right? The history of Vidura's appearance in the world, how Yamaraj was cursed to take birth as Vidura in the earth planet. Do you know this story? This is a story. Who can tell us the story? Who is a storyteller?
Hare Krishna. Yes.
Prem Kishore Prabhu.
Prabhuji, I will try my best. My obeisance is all Krishna Prabhupada. Mandavya Rishi, he was a great sage and he was devotee of Lord. And one day there was a theft in the king's palace, and all the soldiers who were looking for the thief, they came to the Mandavya Rishi's ashram. And at that time, these thieves were hiding in the ashram of Mandavya Rishi. So along with the thieves, they also punished Mandavya Rishi. So when Mandavya Rishi met Yamaraj, and he asked him that, why was I punished? So he said that when you were a child, you pierced the arrow of a small insect with the sharp instrument, and hence this was your punishment. So Mandavya Rishi said that a child, when unknowingly does, child is innocent, so he should not be punished for the acts performed. So he cursed Yamaraj and he said that you will have to born as a Shudra because you have done a Shudra activity. And that's how he was born as a Vidura. Thank you.
And how he became the spiritual teacher? Yes, Shudra. For Prabhupada says in the purport.
Yes, you and then he requested.
No, that, somebody else. Who can tell us, Vidura being a Shudra, how he became the spiritual preceptor? Hare Krishna, who can tell us? Anjana Tirtha Prabhu?
Hare Krishna Prabhu, Dandavat, all praise to Prabhupada. Well, I'm not sure if this is the answer, but I think it has to do with how he was conceived. It was what happened was Vyasadeva was supposed to conceive from Mahabharata the queen Ambika, but seeing Vyasadeva, she was not willing to have him as the father. So she instead sends her maid servant, and the maid servant serves him nicely. But after everything, Vyasadeva realizes that she was not the queen. But she blesses the maid servant. I mean, he blesses the maid servant that the son born will be of, you know, high intelligence and will have good qualities, but will never be able to be the king. Thus, Vidura always had a good insight on how to rule and diplomacy and a lot of other qualities, which was blessed by Vyasadeva. I remember reading somewhere, but I'm not sure if that's the entire context.
Okay, Umesh Prabhu. Let us hear from Umesh Prabhu.
So, I mean, in terms of he being a spiritual preceptor, I think it's clearly mentioned that he was thoroughly enlightened by Matyamuni. And then Prabhupada says that he can occupy the position of Acharya, because, and then he quotes about what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Kiva Viprakiban Nasi Kiva Sutra. I think that's the verse which Prabhupada quotes. Yeah, but he gives a translation that it's not about the birth which decides you being a spiritual master, but rather Krishna Tattvaviti.
Jai Krishna Tattvavetta Sei Guru Hai. Okay, Umesh Prabhu, he gave some points from Prabhupada's purport. There's a message in the chat box. Yamaraj wanted to preach the glories of the Lord, and so he was cursed to come and work. That is a great devotee. Okay. Any other explanation you have? How can you explain this? Vidura, who was born in the womb of a Shudra woman, he became the spiritual guide, teacher. Yes, Sushara Padma Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam. He's a Mahajan as such, and so that is the main reason. Since he was cursed, he came as Vidura. But if not being a Mahajan, his heart is actually filled with giving the glories of Lord Sri Krishna to others. That is the main quality of the pure devotee. He wants to give it to others. So, but since he is in his official work, very busy, as it explains in this passage, he's all the time busy. And so, by the will of the Lord, he was actually being cursed just by Manduka Muni to come down to this earthly planet to give this message. So the rest of it is just the will of Lord Sri Krishna, that he met Maitreya Muni, answered, questioned him, and got all the enlightenment. So that's just a part of the will of Lord Sri Krishna.
Excellent. Rajesh Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Dharma Pram. The answers are correct in terms of Vidura having the desire to preach the glories, but how the Shudra can become a spiritual teacher is by approaching a bona fide spiritual master. A Shudra can become a spiritual teacher by approaching a bona fide spiritual master.
See, here in this connection, we are discussing particularly about Vidura. Charupadma Mataji, she, you know, hinted the fact that, of course, she was not a Shudra. He is originally Mahajan, right? So Jamaraj is one of these 12 Mahajanas. And he came because Supreme Lord wants to reclaim the conditioned souls. And sometimes the Lord takes incarnation like board incarnation, properly speaking, in the purport. Doesn't mean that Lord, you know, becomes abominable like an ordinary creature, like a boar, he has taken his birth. No, is not to be seen with such low class mentality. Prabhupada is saying the Lord and his different authorized devotees sometimes have to play the role of many lower creatures to claim the conditioned souls. But both the Lord and his pure devotees are always in the transcendental position. So in that way, and also of course, Kiva Viprakibanya Sudra Kranoi, Jai Krishna Tattavitta, Sei Guru Hai. So then now, in text number 16th, Yudhishthiro Labdha Rajya Dishtva Pautram Kulandharam Bhatruvhi Lokapalabhi Mamude Paramas Parayasya. So in that way, when Maharaj Yudhishthir, he became the king, actually, he was ruling the kingdom, he was representing Maharaj Dhritarashtra. And here it is said that his brothers are like Lokapalas. They're like the administrative gods who are helping the Supreme Lord in the administration of the universe. Lokapalavai, Mumudeha Purayasriya. And there are opulence flowing everywhere in his country during his reign. So in that way, he continued ruling the kingdom. Evam griheshu sobha shaktanam pramattanam tadihaya atyakramat abhijnatah kala paramadustara. Even though Maharaj Yudhishthir, he had such an opulent kingdom, but kala paramadustara. Everything is destroyed by the will of the time. So he had such a beautiful kingdom, everything was very nice. Then gradually started to dwindle. So then what happens? Finally, you know, Prabhupada writes something very important, interesting in the purport. He's saying, real transcendentalists are hungry for his happiness, and as a hungry man cannot be made happy by all comforts of life, minus foodstuff. So the man hungry for eternal absolute happiness cannot be satisfied by any amount of material happiness. See, Maharaj Yudhishthir, even though he had such a beautiful kingdom filled with opulences, but he was not happy with this material opulence. Just like, so a hungry man is not just happy with any kind of material comfort without food. Because the food for the devotee is the devotional service of the Lord. Therefore, the instruction described in this verse cannot be applied to Maharaj Yudhishthira. That you should not think that when it is said, if you see the Sanskrit, that he was parayasya. He was actually very happy, he had a lot of opulence. No. He was not actually enjoying this. Previously, we have heard that Maharaj Yudhishthir took up the role of a king in Hastinapur because he wanted to satisfy the Supreme Lord, because Lord wanted it. But actually, he was not very much happy to be in the midst of such material opulence. Therefore, Prabhupada is saying, therefore, the instruction described in this verse cannot be applied to Maharaj Yudhishthira or his brothers and mother. It was meant for persons like Dhritarashtra, for whom Vidura came especially to impart lessons. So here, while staying in Hastinapur, one day Vidura finds Dhritarashtra alone, and he's found that this is a correct time to give him some injection. And he said, "My dear brother, what is going on here? Get out from this house as quick as possible. And you think these boys who are treating you like king, and he's giving you such a royal treatment, and you'll enjoy this sukha, this royal happiness for the rest of your life?" Signam pasidam bhayamagatam. Just see, danger is waiting for you. Actually, not that Maharaj Yudhishthira is going to treat badly, therefore Vidura is speaking. No. Vidura's interest is that she has to instruct Dhritarashtra so that he will develop the mood of renunciation and he will quit home. Therefore, he is saying that Maharaj Yudhishthira, maybe he is treating you so well, but tomorrow, who knows? Maybe you will not be treated so well. Of course, this is not applicable for Maharaj Yudhishthira, but it is applicable to all of us. We construct such a beautiful house. We have so much bank balance, so much opulence around us. And we think, no, now I have my family, my children, everybody will take care of me in old age. But what they're going to do to you at the old age, you don't know. Something is waiting very serious for you. Therefore, you have to make your own plan that you should become Narottama. So in the course of instruction, Narad Muni, he is going to tell, sorry, yeah, Narad Muni is going to tell that, Vidura is going to tell that you become Narottam. You don't be, sorry, you become Dhira if you cannot become Narottama. Means Narottama is one who does not wait for such a time when he is suffering and he is thinking, oh, what I have done in my life. I should have prepared myself before, well ahead of time. Instead of coming to that situation, a devotee, he is a Narottama, he is a perfect, human being, and he makes all the arrangements well ahead of time. Before he comes to such a situation, he prepares everything. So that is the point for us, that we don't know. We may be in a very good situation today, and tomorrow, by the influence of time, we may have to face a lot of difficulties, troubles. Therefore, we should put priority to make necessary arrangements for our spiritual growth. At the same time, those who are dependent on us, whatever necessary activities to be accomplished for them, we must do that. That should be the wise decision for anybody. Pratik kriya nadasya kutas chitkar hichit prabhu soyesa bhagavan kala sarvi samna samagataha. This frightful situation cannot be remembered by any person in this material world. My Lord, it is the supreme personality of Godhead as eternal time, Kala, that has approached us all. Prabhupada writes in the beginning of the purport, there is no superior power which can check the cruel hands of death. No one wants to die, however acute the source of bodily sufferings may be. Even in the days of so-called scientific advancement of knowledge, there is no remedial measure, either for old age or for death. Old age is the notice of the arrival of death served by cruel time. And no one can refuse to accept either summon calls or the supreme judgment of eternal time. This is explained before Dhritarashtra, because he might ask Vidura to find out some remedial measure for the imminent fearful situation, as he had ordered many times before. Before ordering, however, Vidura informed Dhrashtra that there was no remedial measure by anyone or from any source in this material world. And because there is no such thing in the material world, death is identical with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as it is said by the Lord himself in Bhagavad Gita. So here Vidura is trying to awaken Dhritarashtra to the platform of realizing that he has to take shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna. There is no way out. Nobody can help him. Therefore, he continues, whoever is under the influence of the Supreme Kala must surrender his most dear life. And what to speak of other things such as wealth, honor, children, land, and home. You see what here Vidura is giving, he is making a very beautiful point that life is very dear to everyone. Life force, right? Nobody wants to die. Everybody wants to remain alive in this body. But how much we try, when time comes, we'll be forced to leave this body. When you cannot live in this body, even though you desire so much to protect your life, then what to speak of this material opulence, wealth, and family, whatever you can say in this world, you are so attached to? No, you should not remain attached to all these things. Therefore, he's saying, your father, brother, well-wishers, and son are all dead and passed away. You yourself have expanded the major portion of life. Your body is now overtaken by invalidity, and you are living in the home of another. So here, actual instructions of Vidura starts to awaken renunciation, the mood of renunciation in Dhritarashtra. So I was thinking, maybe you can just look at this section. Oh, it is not shared, right? Okay. So what you can do is read this text number 21 to 28. And identify principles for Vidura's instruction as an arousing renunciation in Dhritarashtra. What is that? Helping Dhritarashtra to renounce this world. One or two points you can find out, identify from 21 to 28. I hope you might have read this before, so we may not give so much time for you, but maybe I would say, okay, take around 7 minutes just to refresh your notes so that you know what are the instructions given by Vidura and what do you understand the principle there which helped the Dhritarashtra to renounce. And so in that way, what is applicable to us? When you are preaching, how can you use this method to awaken the mood of renunciation in someone? Okay, what is the principle here? So just take a look at it, and then we will discuss. Okay. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, dear devotees, we'd like to share what are your thoughts, how one should prepare for renunciation. How do you know that he is progressing on the path of renunciation? Let us put it like this. Here, there are some points you can explain that these are the indication that you can measure. This is what is happening to this person means he is progressing on the path of renunciation. Am I confusing you or you would? Yes. Okay. Good. Now there are some hands. Okay. All on a sudden. Ayendra Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. So here, there's a few points raised by Vidura. For example, he's telling that it's better, instead of living a degraded life, which is like
please,
living on.
Please refer to the verse. Which verse you are referring to, so that we all can look into it, because we haven't seen it.
Okay, so I'll start with the first one, verse 21.
Okay.
He's saying, body is overtaken by invalidity, and he's living in another person's house to Dhritarashtra, right? So that's kind of, he's living on somebody else's place, kind of like. And then I'll just quickly mention some of my points. And second, he says, number two, verse 22, symptoms of old age. So this is another point that he raises. Third, he says, Dhritarashtra is living on some other people's care, like a household dog, and taking fruit from Bhima. So fourth is saying that he's living a degraded life. He's living on charity from those who he tried to kill. And then another point, you say,
okay, he's living. So I understand what you are saying. Let us hear from some other devotees. I am looking for some other interesting points. Manoranjan Prabhu, Madan Mohan Prabhu.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji. in these verses, I find like a description of Dhritarashtra's particular situation described, like say 21 to 24, like Prabhuji was reading now. So, you know, like you asked, like how, like draw the principle and how you find it applicable for preaching. So I was thinking that if we try, I don't know, I'm just asking also, like if we try, because this situation is very, because Dhritarashtra's situation is not very good, because he has lost his so many near and dear ones, and he is also depending on others. He is already old and going to be invalid and so on. So when we try to preach someone and he is not in such a situation, then at least from 21 to 24, I don't know how it will be applicable, Prabhuji. But yes. from 25 to 28, there are definitely, I mean, even in these verses also definitely nice points. So I'll just read some principles that I just...
from 25 onwards.
Yeah. So like even 21 to 24, Prabhupada's rise, everyone's situation here is very precarious. Now, this is a very nice principle, but how it depends on the preacher's realization to bring it out. I have seen like someone who is very realized, he can make the hearer realize that it's a very precarious situation. So you can ask, you like
from verse number 25 to 28.
Okay, so I was thinking like 25 particularly, like this body will fall anyway, one day this body will fall. It is true for Dhritarashtra, it's true for everyone. So we may take care of in different ways, but this body will fall one day. And the Prabhupada also says this body is meant for cultivating devotional service to the Lord. So do not waste. Okay. And
let us hear from some other devotees, Manojan Prabhu, Madhava Madharman Prabhu. Umesh Prabhu, please tell only one point.
Yes, Prabhu. So the one of the points which I think which I understood was that if we make this body as a permanent settlement, I mean, difficult to be real about that. At a certain point, you will have to give up this body. So even at the cost of death, you cannot miss out the main mission of the life, which is to solve the cycle of birth and death. So if that comes at the cost of death, which means if you have to come out of your comfort zone and go for it, you should be. So that probably can encourage someone. But as Madan Mohan Prabhu said, that it depends how realized you are and how well they will embrace it. But that's the point which I'll take back to. That one has to eventually give up the comfort zone.
Gopi Gona Gita Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, Dandat Pranam. Prabhu, in 25, verse number 25, it's Pariyatya Anichito Jirno Jaraya Vastasi Iva. That, you know, it means that whether one desires it or not, the body will certainly dwindle and deteriorate. So human life is usually, it is meant for reviving one's eternal relationship with the Lord. And, you know, it has the dormant intention which is there inside has to be awakened. And Dhritarashtra, due to his wrong conception of life, had already spoiled all his 80% of his energy of his life. And therefore, he was tightly bound with the material affinities related to the politics and economy and the family attachment, everything he had. So, in 26...
I got it, Mataji. I will explain something. Like not two, like Manojan Prabhu, Madan Mohan Prabhu and you have entered on the same verse. It's interesting.
And in 26, they have given a renunciation path, Prabhu. However, the path of renunciation is based on the frustration because he is living a frustrated life. So that is why they are saying that but for stabilization of such renunciation is possible only by the association of bona fide saints and self-realized soul.
Okay, good. That's a nice thing. They are also in 26. We will come back to that. Let us hear from quickly Radha Vinod Prabhu. No. Prema Gaurangi Mataji. Haribol.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. So what I've got from 21 to 28, I've jot down the points.
Just share one point.
So 26 and 27, Vidura is explaining about the position of a dhira, a person who is undisturbed. And also he points out like the importance of remembering the Lord and how this would put you into the first class man, like already you're in a degraded situation, but how you can advance to a position of a first class man. So this is one point that I'd like to.
Okay, very quickly, Radha Vinod Prabhu, can you just quickly tell your point?
Yeah, Prabhuji, as Mother was saying, I was just going the dhira to Navratam. So if it's not possible, the material world is Shashwat, Dukkhalay, and seeing all, don't try to make amend the ways. It's not possible. So if, as you say, that body will fail and all this thing. So at least go to the dhira. So try to become a steady. Calamities will come and then look forward towards the Navratam. Right? Narottam.
Okay. This Narottama principle coming again and again. Rajesh Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. I'll go to verse number 25. Many have pointed out. If I am living like a Kripana, meaning I have no estimation of my body, I want to enjoy, that means I'm not progressing on the path of spirituality. If I am able to live like a Brahmana or think at least as a start, then I will know not just myself, but also my material body. That way I will know, or I can explain to somebody how to progress on the path of renunciation. Okay.
So the verse number 25 and 26 is coming repeatedly again and again. Looks like there is something we have to dig there. Okay, nice. Madan Mohan Dev Prabhu.
Prabhu, Hare Krishna Prabhu, Dandapanam Prabhu. So Prabhu, regarding the renunciation, I want to share. Actually, Duryodhana is the only person throw him out. Now he is died. Now Vidura got chance to live very nicely without any obstruction, without enemy. But he didn't take that chance. He was enlightening his brother, go for renunciation. So he didn't planning to enjoy the life, but he also decided to go renunciation. So we have to appreciate that Vidura for taking this decision, bro.
Okay.
Not only taking decision, he is enlightening his brother also to take renunciation. So we have to appreciate Vidura's point of view.
Okay, good. So let us look at it. You see, here it is said, in 25, in the purport, Prabhupada is explaining that human life is meant for finishing all kinds of miseries of material existence. And life should be so regulated that one can achieve the desired goal. Okay. So here, when he's saying human life is meant for finishing all kinds of miseries of material existence, how can one bring an end to the miseries of material life? How can you finish the miseries in human existence, in human life, human form of life? Because as long as you are in this body, the misery is supposed to appear, right? It will come one after another. So when Prabhupada is saying then he's saying they want the and life should be so regulated that one can achieve the desired goal. See, we always are very much attached to the comforts of this material body. And we don't want any kind of, you know, suffering appearing, painful situation appearing through this body, right? So therefore, according to Acharya's understanding, as long as we have got this body, the painful situation of this material existence is going to appear through this material body. But who is qualified to attain the goal, the mukti? One who tolerates. Okay? So if you know the art of tolerating through the regulated life, then you are marching towards the goal of attaining liberation, moksha. That is how actually you are gradually becoming denounced, which is connected with the verse forward that you have to become a Narottama. What does it mean? Becoming, by means of becoming Narottama. The Sanskrit verse says, Yaha Swakat Parato Veha Jata Nirveda Atmavan. The word Nirveda is here. Here, Nirveda means you automatically become detached, indifferent to the material realm. How can you become? He is saying, Swakat Parato Ba Yaha Jata Nirveda. Yaha Nirveda Jata. How? Swakat Ba Parato. Swakat Ba Parato means, as a sadhaka, we have to put our endeavor. Means you read Shastra, you associate with the devotees, you willfully undertake the practices of Krishna consciousness. That means that is the meaning of Swakat. And Parata, in association with the devotees, you hear and you apply such practices in your life. That is the way. Swakat Parata Vaiha Jata Nirveda Atmavan. So without you knowing that how you can become a Narottama. Therefore, here, according to Srila Sridhar Swami, Narottamastu Tatah Prag Eva Krita Pratikaraha. So you know that nothing can help me to become comfortable in this world. How much I may try to bring a comfortable situation for my living, by the will of the Lord, everything will come to an end. Right? How much we try, definitely this is going to be destroyed. So therefore, it is best way for me to is make a permanent solution. What is that? How I am going to become more Krishna conscious? How am I going to commit myself to the execution of Krishna conscious activities more and more? That is the real mood of renunciation. Otherwise, not that like Dhritarashtra, his son is dead, he is living in the house of his enemy, you know, Bhima is giving him some food. In our situation, it is not like that actually. That's why Swakat Parato Vaiha Jata Nirvada Atmavan. So you have to be very, very cautious in your personal endeavor to read Shastra, to find the practices, and in the association of the devotees, you get the correct knowledge, and well beforehand, you plan your life. This is most important. The thing is planning. If I ask this question to all of you, my dear students, how many of you have a plan in place in your life? Tell me. Yes. Good. Okay. Very good. Some of you have plan. I'm very happy to hear this. One, two, three, four, five. Okay, good. What do you mean by plan? Rajini Gopika, you have a plan? Prema Gurangi?
Yes, Prabhu.
Say that. What is the plan? If you don't want to share with us, no problem. We will not force you. Anyone would like to share the plan? Yes? Prema Gurangi Matji?
Prabhuji, Ayindra Prabhu will explain.
Okay, Ayindra Prabhu will explain.
Like, for me, like how you want to spend the rest of your life and in Krishna conscious and implement it every day, like in a very practical way, so that you're going towards that goal.
Okay. So, very good. Especially those who are couples. You see, we are definitely not following the Karmakanda division of the Veda, that we, along with our wife, we try to execute the religious practices so that we can be happy here. And after leaving this body, again, we will be take birth in the same family, or, you know, again, we will be uniting with each other in the next life. Our concept is not like that. Even though some Karmi people, they have such kind of confused understanding, and they do desire to be born in the next life as the husband and wife, something like that. They have some kind of, you know, desire. Karmi people, they have. But here, as a devotee, you need to make a plan as a Krishna conscious couple. Most of you are kind of, you know, here grihasthas. It is your duty to talk to your husband or wife, and both of you should agree to the common principle that from today on, whatever your situation, life situation may be, if you are very young, you have a kind of, you know, okay, now you have to give birth to the baby, you have to make a plan. And, you know, after baby is born, how are you going to do? That is one thing. Okay, if your life is kind of, you know, gone beyond that stage, now you need to talk to each other that, okay, now really we should help each other how we can grow in our Krishna consciousness. Because who is your best friend? Husband or wife, both of you, because you are very close to each other. And in any way, you're going to stay there in your house. You cannot avoid this life. You are not a brahmachari. Let us embrace the practical life situation. Make a joint plan. That how are you going to execute your Krishna conscious activities so that you are moving forward? And this is the plan you have to make. Not that, you know, till the end of your life, you are still, you know, hovering around your life to earn more money, to look for a better, you know, sense gratification, the opportunity. No, it's not the way of our life. This life is gone. Okay. I have, you know, how much I can try to enjoy? No, it's not possible. So we have to make some plan. Shanti.
Hi, Krishna. To be able to speak about Krishna to others, that's my big goal. So yeah, I have a plan as far as what I'm studying and for how long, and hopefully it works out. I don't know, it's still his arrangement.
Okay. Achar prachar name karo dui karyo. Many times we give a lot of emphasis into I have to preach. Prabhupada has said, my Guru Maharaj has said, my Shiksha Guru is saying, yes, everybody should preach. But don't just preach at the cost of not practicing. You have no time to practice what you preach, what you teach. If you practice, your preaching will have more effect. This will be another part of your preparation. You should add. Anyone else? Gopikona Mata, you want to say something? Or Nimayanitai Prabhu? Okay, Nimayanitai Prabhu, no, he disappeared again. Okay, Gopikona Gita Mataji.
Yes, Prabhu. Like making the ground now itself, like here now we have been in association with devotees. But we are not going to continue our life here. We'll be going back and settling. So we are making a ground now itself where we are going to stay, where in association of devotees, staying together with the, like a community with the devotees, so that, you know, one is there to give us an enthusiasm back. Even though we fall down, sometimes, you know, due to some material, we are okay. Just material and relationship.
Your plan is clear. Come to Mayapur, stay in Mayapur. Lot of association is here, and we are ready to give you some service here also. Okay, no problem. Good. Okay,
thank you.
Nice plan. Nimai Nitai Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Yeah. So, I mean, I'd like to share that, you know, plan, we have to plan to do the planning as well. So, yeah. And yeah, that is the most lacking part nowadays. So I'd like to, you know, address this this is very important topic, but people are not just putting their mind together and do this thing. So it's very important to do planning. And yeah, as a devotee, we can do our planning according to our time, place, and circumstances and whatever the availability. But here in this chapter, I mean, today I was very much, it's very realized that Srimad Bhagavatam is covering all the subject, all the aspects of the life, how to live. And this is one of the very important, that how to retire and how to plan your, you know, diminishing a body, okay. Or so, yeah, okay. It's very important part to plan. Yeah.
Okay. Madan Mohan Prabhu?
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Like the plans I have seen in my limited experience are in different categories. One is preaching, like some plans for preaching. Then another is plans for regulation. Another is plans for reducing material encumbrance. And also I have seen when the intensity of devotional service is good, then there are more plans. More desire to progress. And when the intensity goes down, the plans also become very hazy. So I'm not saying like I don't have any specific plan or not, but what I'm trying to say is that I'm just praying to God that I should continue the intensity and God will show me path as I progress. So that's okay. Something.
Prem Guranga Mataji, I'm not going to take your point, okay?
Prabhuji, so, I had a question, I had a question on this topic.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
Prabhuji, we as devotees, we do understand what Vidura is explaining to Dhritarashtra from 21 to 28. But what do we do about our parents? Maybe our parents are not devotees, are not in Krishna consciousness, just like Dhritarashtra was. But at the end of the life, like when we see that the body is deteriorating and what can we do for them? And especially
specifically, since you are asking this question, for you find out a devotee who your father is very much close to. I know your father is very much close to someone. He listens. I mean to say he's a devotee. You just identify that person and help your father by taking assistance from that devotee. It will definitely work for your father.
But what about if we have siblings who are like... we could be putting the Krishna conscious side, but then the siblings are putting the material side. Okay, you have a house, you have beautiful.
No, I'm not going to comment anything about that. My question is how you going to make a plan for your life to ultimately come to a point of renunciation and attaining moksha, attaining the love of Godhead. Okay. You cannot ask me a different question. That is totally different. I am not going to discuss about that. You ask about your father. For your father, I told you. Your father is very close to a devotee. I mean to say he listens. He will listen definitely. You find out, you talk to that person, and he talks, as he talks to your father, your father will be kind of, you know, progressing. Okay. So the point here is, here the main point is, as long as you continue to live in this body, there will be some problem appearing. We need to learn how to tolerate it, making the real plan to practice our Krishna conscious activities. And especially when, as a grihastha, you cannot neglect the kind of, you know, demand or the mood, the desire of the better half of your life, so that you have to make a joint plan together, so that your Krishna conscious executions will lead you to a point where you become more and more dependent on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Number one. And number two, is all, everything is dependent on becoming a Narottam, means you are planning. Planning is very, very important. And when you plan and you start working on your plan, as Madan Mohan Prabhu was saying, there will be more opportunity, there will be more service, there will be more kind of, you know, opportunities. Then it looks like plan becomes hedgy. So how to avoid that part? You should understand what is your limit, how much you can take on your plate. And what is your main focus? Main focus is, am I gradually growing towards renouncing this world and getting the love of Godhead? Or I am always running, quarreling, fighting. I don't know why I am doing all these things. Sometimes I go back and look into my situation and I'm also confused. Take some help, make a concrete plan, and be happy and peaceful in your Krishna consciousness. Otherwise, taking so much load for preaching, and you don't know what you are doing. Preaching has to be done not at the cost of sacrificing your own Krishna consciousness. Okay, so then, Vidura, he went on talking to his brother until he was ready. And finally, he was prepared, and then he left the home at midnight. And when Dhritarashtra left home, Gandhari, she also followed her husband. And where did she go? They go to the southern part of the Himalayan mountain. And it is said that, well, you know, they were living in a nice place, right, in a royal, they belong to the royal family. So why did, at least, you know, Gandhari decide to leave? After all, she is a lady. She's supposed to be in a very comfortable and protected environment. Living on the hill station of Himalaya is not a very comfortable life. Lot of cold, you know, very cold climate. And, you know, there's nothing to eat sometimes. Why did she decide? Why did she choose to go there? Again, the dukkha, the, you know, suffering which comes, you need to learn how to tolerate. In this connection, it is explained that the drishtanta has been given. Manasinameva satsampraharaha. If you see text number 30, there's a nice analogy has been given how somebody who has entered in the renounced order of life, how does he take to the troubles that are coming through their experience through this material body. He's saying, manasvina meva sat sampraharaha. When a fighter goes to the battlefield, and when he is faced with the sharpened arrows or strike of the enemies, he actually enjoys. A true Kshatriya, when he is pierced with the arrows of his enemy, he is very joyful. Why?
If he leaves his body, he is going to go to the heaven. If he is going to conquer the battle, he is going to enjoy the kingdom here. Okay. So he is very happy, very, very, very brave. So similarly, with that mood, when the devotee is kind of renouncing the world, there is some distressful situation, there is some pain. He is tolerating it like who? Like a warrior, brave soldier, which is very, very enjoying to him. Brahmana, in the winter time, he doesn't wear anything. Very happy. He's tolerating because he's doing it for Krishna. He's serving Krishna. And he knows he has got a better destination. By serving the Lord, he tolerates everything in the service of the Lord. So in that way, Gandhari left along with her husband. And then what happens? In the meantime, one day, and then the next morning actually, the night Dhritarashtra Gandhari left home, then the next morning, Maharaj Yudhishthir, after completing his daily rituals, every day Maharaj Yudhishthir, he used to perform his daily rituals. What are those daily rituals? He would worship the sun god, means he would chant Gayatri Mantra. He would do Agnihatra, Yajna, and then he would go to his parents, like Gandhari, Dhritarashtra, he will offer them obeisances, and he will distribute charity to the Brahmanas, cow, land, gold. So this was his daily activity. So on that fine morning, when he, after performing his, after chanting Gayatri Mantra, performing all the rituals, having completed the Agnihatra Yajna, as he entered into the quarters of Dhritarashtra, he found none of them are there. Neither Dhritarashtra, nor Vidura, nor Gandhari. Whole house was empty. Then he went to Sanjaya, Dhritarashtra's private secretary. He said, Sanjay, what happened? I don't find my uncles, my auntie. Where did they go? You must know, right? You are their personal secretary. And then Sanjaya said, Naham Veda Vyavasitam Pitur Va Kulanandanaha. He is addressing Maharaj Yudhishthir as Kulanandanaha. Oh, descendant of the Kuru dynasty, you always bring happiness to this family. But what can I say? Naham Veda Vyavasitam. Actually, I don't know. What did they decide? Even Gandhari also, they did not tell me anything. They actually cheated me. I don't know. Why did they do that to me? And then, finally, while he was discussing with Maharaj Yudhishthir, I mean, when the Sanjay and Yudhishthir were discussing, at that time, Narad Muni arrives on the spot. And when Narad Muni arrived, then Yudhishthir Maharaj, he started talking to Narad Muni. He said, Karna dhara iva pare bhagavan paradarsakaha. Bhagavan paradarsaka. Actually, you help the people to attain perfection. So, my dear Narad Rishi, you are the greatest of the philosopher devotees. He is saying, Muni Sattam, Narada Muni Sattam, Bhagavan, Narada Muni Sattam. So, please, tell me, can you give me some information about my father and mother? Where did they go? My uncle, my auntie? Kindly tell me. Then Narad Muni said, okay, now I'm definitely going to tell you. But I know when you are in this, lamenting situation, I cannot tell you directly where they have gone, what they have done. First of all, I have to give you some instructions where you should go beyond this grief. Then only I can tell you. Therefore, Narad Muni, he chose to explain how this entire world is under the control of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. My dear Yudhishthir, you are thinking they are your parents, you should maintain them, and you should take care of them, you know, give their livelihood. Do you know what is your situation? He is giving a very nice analogy. He is saying, first of all, that everybody is under the control of the Lord. How? Here, the varnashram system has been brought into the attention, like Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra. They are supposed to follow the prescribed duties as per the Vedic injunctions. And in that way, everybody is under the control of the Supreme Lord. And then again, he says, when you are trying to take care of your parents, what is the guarantee that you can do that? It is not possible. When he's giving the example that when one living entity is being swallowed by a serpent, how can he protect the other living entity? No, it is not possible. That's why he's saying, kala karma gunadhana dehayam pancha bhautika. This material body, which is under the influence of kala, karma, and guna, means it is on the jaws of death. It cannot give protection to others. And also, he was speaking about that, he said, another analogy he has given. Actually, we are controlled by the will of the Supreme Lord. How? Just like a person who is playing with the dolls. The dolls keep moving. He can keep on moving dolls according to his desires, right? Similarly, we, the living entities, are being born in different life situations under the control of the Supreme Lord. So here, if you see from text number 41, Narada Vacha, Ma Kanchana Shucha Rajan Jadishwara Vasam Jagat. This whole world is under the control of the Ishwara. How? Everybody, those who are in different varnashram institutions, they have to follow the injunctions of Shastra. That is how they are under the control. Then the other thing he is saying, that just like Lord is actually in control. How? The next analogy he is giving, when somebody is trying, he is playing with the dolls. As he plays the doll according to his desires, the doll keeps moving. Similarly, we have been born into different life situations by the will of the Lord. Prabhupada gives the example, somebody is born with a silver spoon on his mouth, and somebody is born in the street. That is happening by the dog, by the Lord. He's actually playing with all of us. So that means we are not independent. We need to understand. Then finally, he gives the example of this sarpagrasta. When somebody is being swallowed by the serpent, how can he protect others? That's why kala karma gunadhina dehayam pancha bhautikam. Text number 46. So this material body, under the influence of the control of the time, action, and mode of material nature, therefore you cannot do anything. Better you should cooperate with the plan of the Supreme Lord. Then the famous verse is spoken by Narada Muni, Ahastani sahastanam apadani chatuspadam halguni tatra mahatam jiva jivasya jivanam. This jiva jivasya jivanam, where you need to understand, sometimes some outside people, they quote this verse and they claim, Bhagavatam explains, jiva jivasya jivanam. Oh, we are allowed to eat meat. Because jiva jivasya jivanam, Bhagavatam is speaking, Narada Muni is speaking. My dear devotees, as a Vaishnava, you need to learn in what context Narada Muni is citing this verse. Means what he has said before, what he is going to speak afterwards. First of all, the theme is flowing here, as we said, that Jag Ishwara Basan Jagat. The entire cosmos, the entire world is under the control of the Supreme Lord. And then when he say kala karma gunadhina dehayam panchabhautikam, that means the point he is trying to make is everywhere there is death. Nobody is out of the jaws of death. So this ahastani sahastanam, this confirms that we are not out of the death situation. So in any way, the death is inevitable for all of us. One is becoming the food for other. That is the main concept. But in any way, even if in literal sense, somebody takes that jiva jivasya jivanam, this human form of life is meant for self-realization. You don't see this statement of Srimad Bhagavatam, the jiva jivasya jivanam. Bhagavatam is a natural commentary on Vedanta Sutra. Vedanta Sutra talks about adhato brahma jigyasa. This human form of life is meant for brahma jigyasa. So how you can progress in your inquiry about the absolute truth? That has been explained very nicely by Srila Prabhupada, that we are supposed to eat what is offered to the Supreme Lord, not that we can just eat whatever we like to satisfy the tongue. So therefore, this verse, when it says jiva jivasya jivanam, first of all, it is giving the message that everybody is under the control of the Supreme Lord, and nobody can escape the death. Everybody has to meet with the death. In that context, then he's saying that how these people in this world, they see so many things, but they're actually the manifestations of the different energies of the Supreme Lord. But actually, they're one without the second. Means everything is in one sense is Lord, because that is the manifestations of Lord's energy. And then he says, so ayam adya maharaja bhagavan bhuta bhavanah. You see, text number 49, I'm just bringing. If you see the text number 46, 47, then going towards 49, in 49 he says, so yam adya maharaja bhagavan bhuta bhavana. That same supreme personality of Godhead, bhuta bhavana, creator or the father of the living entity, living creature, he has taken his appearance. Kala rupa vatirnasya abhavaya suradvisham. So he has appeared in this earth planet just to eradicate those who are against the will of the Supreme Lord. He is here to annihilate the miscreants. So therefore, and where he has appeared in Dwaraka. Now he has appeared in Dwaraka. So you can see the entire section how that everything is under control of the Supreme Lord Krishna, who has appeared in Dwaraka, and nobody can escape the death. Therefore, we should submit ourselves to the plan of the Lord. And as an inhuman form of life, we're supposed to attain self-realization. This is the entire kind of, you can say, the theme flowing. Not that all of a sudden you just quote a verse saying, jiva jiva se jivanam, everybody is allowed to eat meat. No, that is not the context. So we have to see purva parabhava, what have been said before, and what is said in this context, and what is said afterwards. So if you link all these things together, then you can draw the conclusion. So anyway, then finally, when Narad Muni started discussing about Dhritarashtra and Vidura, then he finally said, my dear king, he's saying to Yudhishthir, that you don't go there, because from now on, in fifth day, he is going to leave his body. So then, how he's going to do that? He will practice Ashtanga Yoga. And the practice of Ashtanga Yoga is also have been explained from text number 53 to 56. So in the practice of Ashtanga Yoga, there are yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, dhyana, dharana, and samadhi, right? So all these principles are followed by a bhakti yogi. We devotees are following Krishna consciousness. We don't practice Ashtanga yoga, but you see how exactly our practices entail the practice of Ashtanga yoga conclusions. Let us see. Here when Dhritarashtra went to where? Went to Haridwar. And he was practicing Ashtanga yoga. First of all, he was following some niyam. What is that niyam? Tatra snanam homa abhaksham bhakshanam cha iti niyama prakta. In Ashtanga yoga practice, the sadhaka supposed to wake up early in the morning, he has to take bath, and after that he has to perform the homa, agnihatra homa, and then he was drinking only water. Okay, and then niyama yajamaha. Yajama means vigata putradya yeshanaha, means he does not have any desire to attain wealth in this world, no desire for sense gratification, no desire for followers. So that is yama. Okay. And then in this way, he continued practicing asana. So if you see our activities, you also wake up early in the morning and you practice your homo. What? Your homo is Mangalarti. Huh? And you chant Krishna's holy name. So, and then you, as you continue, you know that, yeah, you are a family man, you have children, you have father and mother, you have to take care of them, but you don't become so much attached to them because you know this is your duty and you perform your duty. At the same time, you try to become more Krishna conscious in the given situation. So in that way, you actually gain the result even better than Ashtanga yoga. In Ashtanga yoga practice, he is finally going to enter into, he will create a fire actually. That fire is going to arise from his own body, which will burn his own body. He doesn't need anyone to come and do the final ritual for him. But in case of us, we don't have to follow that practice because we are Vaishnavas, and you can, by simply meditating on the personality of Godhead, when you leave your body, automatically you go to the abode of the Supreme Lord and remain engaged in his service. Therefore, you don't require to practice this Ashtanga yoga process. You see, in Ashtanga yoga process practice, let me tell you one impracticality. When somebody practices Ashtanga yoga by practicing this yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, dhyana, and dharana, even up to samadhi stage, what do they do? In samadhi stage, they actually, how do they enter into samadhi? The Ashtanga yoga process teaches this system is that, first of all, the yogi supposed to withdraw his senses from sensual activities and focus on his intelligence. That intelligence will eventually merge with the soul, that I am aham brahmasmi, I am spirit soul. And then after that, he does not bother anything about the external world, what he sees, what he experiences with his body. He totally remains oblivious. And then he will again transfer his consciousness to merge with the totality. That is the Supreme Personality of God, who is the Adhara, who is the sustainer of everything. So that is how they do. And that, you know, example have been given here. If you see in text number, in text number 55, Ghatambara Mivambare, So the Mayavadis, they like this analogy very much, that the ambara, the sky, which is contained in the pot, when the pot is broken, then the sky in the pot merges the totality of the sky, right? Ghatam, ghatambara mivambare. But actually Vaishnava understanding is different. Prabhupada explaining very nicely. A pure devotee of the Lord does not live on any planet of the material sky, nor does he feel any contact with material elements. His so-called material body does not exist, being surcharged with the spiritual current of the Lord's identical interest. And thus, he is permanently freed from all contaminations of the sum total of the Mahatattva. He is always in the spiritual sky, which he attains by being transcendental to the sevenfold material coverings by the effect of his devotional service. The conditioned souls are within the coverings, whereas the liberated souls are far beyond the covering. So you see, this is the understanding of the Vaishnavas, Acharyas, that we don't just explain this Ghatakas Patakas theory, that when this pot is broken, then the sky in the pot merge with the totality of the sky. No, our understanding is we don't actually focus our consciousness in the material sky. That means we don't identify ourselves with any material objects to be happy. And then we try to conceive the plan of the Lord, and we act according to his plan. Then we become one with the Supreme Lord in that way. And then through the execution of devotional service, the conditioned soul is automatically beyond the material sky. He's not under the influence, he's not covered. That is the understanding. So, anyway, this is how he practiced Ashtanga Yoga, and he meditated upon the Supreme Lord. Then finally, he left his body. And when Mother Gandhari, outside, she saw her husband created the fire and burnt his body, then she also entered into the funeral pyre. And then she left her body as well. In that connection, Prabhupada is speaking about the sati rites. It was prominent in the society long before, but nowadays, when the ladies, the wife is not ready to enter into the funeral pyre of her husband, she should not be forced to do so, because that's a criminal act. Therefore, in the modern world, it was abolished. The Satidaha Pratha is already abolished. That is the point when the rite became formality only, and force was applied upon the lady to follow the principle. Actually, it became criminal, and therefore the ceremony was to be stopped by state law. This prophecy of Narada Muni to Maharaj Yudhishthir forbade him to go to his widow aunt. So finally he understood that there is no point for me to go and meet with them. Then finally he says, Vidura, being affected with delight and grief, will then leave the place of sacred pilgrimage. So he's saying, when Vidura will see that his brother, he has ended his life like this, in one way because he is his brother, he will have some kind of grief. At the same time, he will be delighted because he has attained moksha. And then he will leave the place. And then, having spoken thus, the great says Narada, along with his Veena, ascended into the outer space. Yudhishthir kept his instructions in his heart, and so was able to get rid of all lamentations. So in this way, Yudhishthir Maharaj became even silent, and he became free from their lamentation upon hearing the instructions of Narada Muni. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Lot of verses, what to do? Anyway, we have completed on time.
So Prabhuji, did Dhritarashtra get impersonal liberation or what exactly he got?
When Vidura was a devotee of the Lord, right? And when Vidura is guiding him, do you think Vidura will guide him to meditate on the impersonal aspect of the Supreme Lord? Let us try to understand this. Who was his guru? His guru was Vidura. And Vidura is a, you know, Mahajana, and he understands Krishna very well. That might be the process he has, you know, told him. Actually, in meditation, they meditate upon the Vishnumurti form of the Lord. As I explained, that they, first of all, withdraw their consciousness, their sensual activities. They fix, you know, their mind in the intelligence. Then intelligence is merged with the soul, where they don't identify with any enjoyable object in this material world. And then they merge in the consciousness of the Supreme Brahman. That is the practice of Ashtanga Yoga. By then, the yogi has perfectly understood who the Supreme Brahman is. Means he is his master, he needs to serve him. And Vidura, being a perfect devotee of the Lord, I can say definitely he is guiding Dhritarashtra to the personal understanding about the Supreme Lord, to meditate upon him and gradually leave his body.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Because I don't want to concoct, I just want to say, who was his guru? You understand, if your guru is a personalist, definitely you will not be kind of in an impersonal, you know, you cannot follow impersonal theory because your guru is a personalist. So here actually what I want to tell, that this Ashtanga Yoga process, when a yogi practices Ashtanga Yoga, as long as he is in the, you know, dharana, dhyana, samadhi platform, he's okay. But the moment his samadhi is broken, then he comes out to this world, what he has to do? He has to interact with everything, right? Since objects are there, he's able to see everything, he has to interact with the people here. That is where they fail actually. But for a bhakti yogi, it is not like that. You are always in samadhi, means you are always conscious about the surrounding, how they are the manifestations of the Lord's external energy, and you don't identify yourself with those energies as an enjoyer, and you are engaged in the service of the Lord in every aspect of your life. Whereas in Ashtanga Yogi, he fails to control himself when he comes out of his samadhi. There's a difference. You understand? He may control himself and he meditates and he enters into samadhi, but when he comes to Bahya Dasa means he is again in involved the external world. Then he is touching everything, he is seeing everything, he is trying to experience everything. Then how can he control his senses? It becomes difficult for them. That is what Vedas says actually about them. But for your understanding, I'm just making it more simple to understand and even explain to anyone who you are preaching to. The fact, like, you find, you talk to somebody who may be your friend going to the yoga school, you ask them, okay, you go to the yoga studio and you sit there, close your eyes for whatever time, and you meditate, and you feel like, you know, you are in the transcendental world, you are hallucinating, you are in a very, you know, ecstatic situation. Now, my dear Prabhu, when you come out of the yoga studio, and then you are in the middle of this big city, and you see everything, you know, eat everything, you do everything, what happens to your senses? What happens to your meditation? Are you kind of, you know, restrained at that time? No, definitely not. If he's an honest person, he will clearly explain. No, it is not possible. That is a flaw in Ashtanga Yoga practice.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Nice.
Okay, my dear devotees. So that is how by Krishna's grace, today we have completed chapter 13. And Krishna willing, we will continue our next week, next unit after following week. That means Vishwasar Govinda Prabhu, next week.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, 3rd of
June will be your closed book test. And by then, I expect you all have submitted your open book assignment and sloka also, whatever is coming in this unit or previous unit, if there is something remaining. If you want to give sloka from the unit ahead, still you can do that. And then we'll resume our class with unit 5 on 10th of June.
No, Prabhu, I think we are looking at the wrong dates. It's yes.
Okay. June 5th.
Yeah, June 12th will be the next unit start, and 5th.
Thank you for rectifying me, because I'm sitting a little far from my calendar. I'm not able to see clear. Yes.
Yeah.
5th June will be a project test, and then 12th June will be start of unit 5, if Krishna willing.
Prabhuji, can I just take a minute, please? I'll just make a couple of announcements in this regard. Yeah. So, as Prabhuji just mentioned, we'll have the closed book test on the 5th of June. As we have been doing in the past, I'll just ensure that the same process is followed, 5th of June. We had already announced that the OBA, that is the essay submission for this particular unit, is due by the 4th of June. I hope all of you are working on that. If you can kindly share it in the same normal mode through the same email ID, giving your name and the unit number. It's also mentioned as part of the subject of this particular WhatsApp group. That's the second one I want to announce. And the third one is any slokas relating to this particular unit will also need to be submitted, please. I have one update on the sloka submission process also. Within MI, there is a new process where we have set up a complete new system where there is a lot of confusion normally, wherein slokas recordings are sent by WhatsApp in transit, they are lost and all this stuff. So just to put everything to rest, there is a new process wherein I will provide you with a link. There you just, like a CBA exam, you just need to put in your name, your batch number, and then the slokas which you are submitting, and then the recordings can directly be uploaded over there. So what happens by this is it goes and sits in a particular drive, and as an evaluator, the person can call for it, download it, give the marks immediately, and that way our rating also gets updated directly. So there is minimal risk of anything being lost in transit. I will anyway send a link on that and a short write-up on that. The only request I have is that for whatever units which you have already submitted, I would be really grateful if you can just submit it for each of those units also all over again, please. That means for unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, and also unit 4. Only the shlokas you need to submit it again, please. Yeah, so that would be really helpful so that we can have everything as part of a common repository. So anyway, I'll drop this message within the group as well. If any queries on any of these, I'll be happy to assist you in any regard. Yeah, thank you very much.
Shanti Mataji.
Just a quick question for people handing in the essay. I thought we were to hand that one in 5 days after the unit's completed. So, for example, for those who haven't handed in their essay, they have this week to do the studying plus the essay. Just want to clarify that.
Mr. Govinda Prabhu?
Yeah, fine, Prabhu. I would go by your advice in this matter. Given that this week there is also the CBA to study for, I think we can provide one extra week also, so that this week they can concentrate on preparing for the CBA and also the slokas. And maybe the week after they can give the OBAs. I'm perfectly fine with that.
Okay, you got your answer? Thank you. You're done, Prabhu. Anything else?
No, nothing from my side, please. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna.
Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram
Ram. Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.